Is there a scientific consensus on climate change? I'm Simon Harrington, and this is Scholar's Mate. Hello and welcome to Scholar's Mate. I'm your host, Simon Harrington. Joining us today are Myron Ebell of the Competitive Enterprise Institute and James Stillwell of the University of Maryland. We've all heard figures that 95%, 97%, even 98% of scientists believe that global warming is occurring and that emissions of greenhouse gases due to human activity is to blame. But, Myron Ebell, you dispute these figures and say that there's no such consensus among scientists. Can you explain?
Simon, there are several issues in these studies that claim that there is a consensus. And I think each one has been debunked to a large extent from a methodological or statistical standpoint. But I think the key issue is that they're saying that there is a consensus about one thing when in fact the studies show that there is a consensus about another thing. And I would say there is a weak consensus, what I would call a weak consensus. The climate is always changing. Greenhouse gases are what keep the planet warmer than the atmosphere warmer than it would otherwise be. Human beings produce a lot of greenhouse gases, primarily from burning coal, oil, natural gas, and producing carbon dioxide. And that all things being equal, that will have some impact on the climate. That's what I would call the weak consensus, and I think that's what these studies, by and large, are talking about. But then they go on to claim a much stronger consensus, which is that this means that the planet is in peril. Things are going to get worse and worse and worse, so we have to do something immediately to start turning the economy upside down and reducing our carbon dioxide emissions. These studies, none of these studies that produce these 97% figures, and they've really kind of converged on 97%. It's kind of like the elections that they used to have in the Soviet Union, where, 99 to 100% of everybody voted for the same candidate, for the Communist Party candidate. And so I think that there is a real scientific consensus, but it doesn't support the alarmist view, and that's what this debate is about. There is a claim that there is a consensus, but it's really a political consensus of a certain group of scientists and their allies in the political world who are pushing the alarmist or energy rationing agenda. So I think there are several things involved here, but when you get right down to it, the consensus is a much weaker thing than has been claimed.
James, how would you like to respond to the consensus being weaker?
Yes, so first of all, it is not weaker. And I want to thank you, Myron, for sharing the floor with me today, and Simon for hosting us today. And the fact is that this is settled science. According to multiple peer-reviewed studies in international national publications, 97% of the world's top climate scientists agree that the climate is changing and human beings are responsible. If you look back at ice cores, tree rings, all the recent data, before the Industrial Revolution, yes, there were some wobbles in the data, but the overall trend since the Industrial Revolution is a large spike up in global temperatures. The climate has always gone through stages in the Earth's history, but since the Industrial Revolution, it's gone through a dramatic change that can't be explained by anything other than anthropogenic global warming. And that is what settled science agrees on. Frankly, this debate, it seems like something that was happening 10 years ago, and even then there was a consensus. Today, to have this debate, it's really, frankly, something that our society needs to pivot away from. We need to move the conversation toward how we're going to have a future of more efficient, non-emitting energy consumption, that we can combat this global climate change that's threatening civilization that's threatening species on our planets. We're currently going through the sixth mass extinction that's human caused. I think it's frankly settled silent science. There's not really much of a debate on that issue.
Myron, would you like to respond to the science?
Well, I think within the climate is a very large issue. It covers a lot of different scientific fields. And I would say, to just take one example of a kind of consensus, up until the late 1990s, and you see this in the first assessment report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and in the second report, there was a consensus that there was, back 2,000 years ago, there was a Roman warm period followed by some cooling in what we sometimes call the Dark Ages, followed by a warming, and there was a medieval warm period, followed by the Little Ice Age starting in the 14th century and not ending until the 19th century. That was the consensus. Then a very small group of papers were published in the late 1990s by Michael Mann and others, the famous hockey stick papers, that they claimed, by analyzing some tree ring data and some other proxy data, that there was 900 years of essentially flat global temperatures, and in the 20th century it went up like the end of a hockey stick, just sudden rise. Now this consensus that everybody agreed on, and there's a huge amount of historical data, hundreds and hundreds of papers, was immediately overturned, and in the next assessment report, which came out in 2001, it was the featured item. It was in the summary, and it was big, color reproductions of the hockey stick graph. And suddenly everybody at the IPCC, the people who control it, decided this consensus that had prevailed for decades in the climate science community was wrong. So there was a new consensus that there was a hockey stick, that we have 900 years of flat temperatures and then 60 or 70 years in the 20th century of very rapid warming, which must be caused by human beings. Well, you know, that consensus has been demolished. The hockey stick has been deconstructed through, not by people in the community, all these IPCC, this very tight-knit group of IPCC scientists defended it, but a couple of outsiders led by Stephen McIntyre and Ross McKittrick, two Canadians, who aren't climate scientists, but Steve McIntyre is a very good statistician. They looked at the methodology and the data, and they showed that it's a fabrication. It's a methodological fabrication. So now we're back to the original consensus. We had a medieval warm period, a little ice age, and now we've had some warming. So consensus come and go. Let's put it that way. And there are many consensus within the climate science field, many of which I think are correct, and some of which will disappear and be replaced by other consensus. But to James's point, that we've all agreed now that global warming is some big social economic problem that we have to do something about. No, I don't think any of the studies that have been done demonstrate that there is a consensus within the community, the scientific community, of qualified climate scientists. Not just, there are lots of scientists who aren't climate scientists, but that it's a vast problem that has to be confronted by the world's governments. That is the political agenda, and there is an attempt to claim that there is a scientific consensus behind it. In fact, what there is, as I said before, there is a political consensus of a small group of scientists who promote this, and anybody who sticks their head out and disagrees will be shouted down, intimidated, bullied, they'll have their funding cut, they'll have their jobs eliminated. Yeah. And so we see this over and over. It just happened this week with a quite distinguished scientist.
Let me get to James on that. James, what about that? That sometimes it's a point of just that the scientists at this point have, it's their survival, their economic livelihood is to...
Right. Yeah, so I want to address Myron's point about Dr. Mann and really go back to, frankly, while Europe cooled during that era that he's discussing, tropical Pacific was going through an unusually warm period, and the level of cooling that was happening at that time is far dwarfed by the amount of warming that's happening now. I mean, we're talking about before the Industrial Revolution, we had about 250 parts per million of CO2 in the atmosphere. Now we're at about 400 and climbing. We've had about 2 degrees worth of warming since the Industrial Revolution. I mean, we're at the upper part of that hockey stick, and I'm glad you used that metaphor because that is what the graphs look like. And yes, so the scientists put out studies that reached this consensus of 97% and agree with the idea of anthropogenic global warming. And then it's up to governments to decide what to do about it. And this isn't some small fringe group, too. This is talking about hundreds participating in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. We're talking about National Academy of Science. I mean, you could name dozens of national and international organizations that all support this consensus. And frankly, I think the fact that that we have 97% saying that there's consensus is even more alarming, because scientists usually they run according to the precautionary principle. They like healthy debate. They'll accept dissenting ideas. They're happy to invite those into the scientific discussion and then meet it out through peer-reviewed literature and then determine what the truth and consensus is. So the fact that we have 97% of scientists all agreeing on this fact that's just settled science. I mean, to them, it's just neutral. Like, here's what's going on. We're not saying what you're supposed to do with it. That, quite frankly, is very alarming, because scientists rarely get into the political implications of what they do in these peer-reviewed journal articles. So yes, we are finding out what we need to do about it now from a governmental standpoint, and that's really up to us now globally and nationally to figure out where to go with that. And that's why we need to pivot towards less emissive, more renewable, non-fossil energy that is more efficient in production and its consumption. And that's where we need to move this conversation.
Well, how do you respond to the people that might say that all these scientists and these companies that are now producing solar energy, mm-hmm. things like that, that are going to benefit economically from these particular... How do you respond to that argument?
So to that, I would say that that's to the good. I mean, I'm happy to discuss the merits and demerits of how we can get to this more efficient, non-emitting energy future. I think if renewable industries benefit from that, that's fine. I think if there's a way that we do it through private enterprise, if we do it through other mechanisms of getting us on a less emissive future, then that works for me. I have no particular one way that we're going to get there. I know that we're not going to get there with fossil energy, which you mentioned that they're going to benefit from this. Frankly, fossil fuels is one of the most heavily subsidized industries globally currently. I mean, I think their current figure, I think in the U.S. we give about $90 billion a year in terms of tax credits, direct subsidies, loosened regulations, et cetera. So they're by far outpacing what renewables are benefiting in any way. And so that's really, if we want to talk about who's benefiting and how we're going to set a more even keel, we need to look at those fossil fuel industry subsidies first.
No, I didn't say the fossil fuels. I was talking about purely about the scientists themselves with the research that they're performing and the companies that are now building, let's take Toyota and the Priuses, right? The fuel efficient cars that we're having to switch over to. So I'm talking about these particular people benefiting from this particular science. Environmental science.
That's industry responding to the science. I'm not sure I follow your point. Sorry.
Okay.
One thing I would say in this is there is no necessary connection between believing that global warming is a huge problem that we have to do something about and a particular public policy prescription. And in general, of course, the last people in the world you would want to ask advice of are the scientists, because they don't know anything about public policy. And in particular, they don't know anything or care much about costs. In fact, of course, many of the policies being, just sort of casually being advocated by the alarmist community are ruinously expensive, will be much more expensive than any projected damages of global warming. And here's a consensus that is often ignored. If you look at the IPCC assessment reports, the last one or the current one, the fourth or the fifth, they make it very clear that there is no long-term historical trend in extreme weather events, droughts, storms, hurricanes, floods. There are no extreme, there is no trend in extreme weather events in terms of their severity or intensity or frequency. Now, is that what you hear from the alarmist community? Why, when these people make these outlandish statements that President Obama seems to endorse and members of Congress, and they quote some scientist or another, why are these people not shouted down and intimidated for not following the consensus? Oh, well, it's because, oh, the IPCC reports are very conservative. They have to sort of, you know, toe the line, so they can't actually tell the truth. Well, no, that's exactly the opposite of the truth. The IPCC reports are designed to support the global warming agenda, so they try to hype things. That's why the hockey stick was a featured item in the 2001 Third Assessment Report. So we find all kinds of consensus, but if it's a consensus that doesn't support the agenda, it's ignored. And if it's a consensus that does support the agenda or is claimed to support the agenda, is this ridiculous claim that 97% of scientists or 97% of published studies. Every one of these studies that has come up with the 97% figure or anything like it, when it's been reanalyzed, it's been found out that most of the papers didn't take a position on the agenda-driven part of the consensus, that is, the global warming is happening, it's a big problem. Instead, they accepted what I called the weaker consensus, namely that there is some global warming, a moderate amount, and it's probably some of it, or most of it, or all of it is caused by human activity. You don't get from there to global warming is a big crisis. And that's what these bogus studies are meant to bridge from the what I've called the weak consensus to this very strong consensus. And you know, if you look at, I've read a long study of all these studies, and there is virtually nothing in them.
Gentlemen, we'll let you have the last word.
Yeah, so I'm glad Myron raised that issue. And again, I want to reiterate that is why I'm particularly concerned about the state of the science that does come to this consensus, because normally scientists, it's not their job to prescribe policy solutions. And these papers, yes, many of them didn't take positions, but a lot of them did. And of the ones that did, 97% said, yes, there is a scientific consensus on global warming. And in fact, in one of the studies, when an independent analysis was done by the researcher, they went back and they asked the scientists themselves, yes, do you agree with the position that from we've gleaned your papers, what we've discovered? And they said, actually, yes, and they found even higher numbers. So I'm particularly concerned that when scientists don't normally come to these conclusions, that they are, in vast numbers, 97% coming out in favor of a consensus on anthropogenic global warming, that they agree. And this idea of ruinously expensive, every year that we delay acting on global climate change adds trillions of dollars to the debt that we're going to have to eventually be paying as a global society, as a national community. I mean, frankly, I think it's irresponsible both to ourselves and to our children and grandchildren to not try and do some of that action now and avoid sticking them with the bill later. Myron mentions that there aren't trends in these mass weather events. I mean, just this week we heard two studies converge on the same observation that the West Antarctic Glacier in Antarctica is falling off. That it's reached, we've reached it. That was a tipping point that has long been put forth by the scientific community. If we've gotten this far with global warming, we're in trouble. And there's several other tipping points, and I don't want to be around to see us not do anything before we reach another.
All right. I'd like to remind our audience that you can submit your questions to our guests through our website, www.publicsquare.net, and we'll answer as many as we can live on the air towards the end of the show. All right, let's take some questions from our viewers. Melanie Hart would like to know, do either of you believe that there are scientists on the other side of the debate who are acting in bad faith?
Yes.
Plain and simple.
I believe that there are, this has been demonstrated over and over, that there are, there is a small group of scientists that essentially control the debate through the IPCC and various U.S. and British government institutions and German. And that quite a few of them are acting in bad faith, yes. But I, I don't want to be sued, so I won't mention any names.
And Jane?
Yes, I agree. And actually, so the IPCC is made up of hundreds of volunteer scientists from around the world who participate in this intergovernmental panel, and they've all converged on this 97%, or actually I think it's 95%, the IPCC says. And what I see on the other side of debate is a lot of articles that purport to debunk this consensus around climate change, and then in fact are just saying, like Myron had mentioned earlier, that some papers don't take a position. So therefore, that's an example that these scientists don't support the consensus, when in fact, that's not the scientist's job in the journal article. And what I find, if you dig a little bit deeper on a lot of the news about, yes, so there's no consensus, or you know, global warming is a hoax, or it's not as bad as we think, you often find behind these supposedly these institutes, these organizations, you often find a lot of funding from industry. You find it from fossil fuel industries, you find it from the Koch brothers, you find it from companies that have a vested interest in advancing a fossil fuel intensive future, which frankly is it's going to send us further on this wrong path and not going to get us towards a less emissive, more efficient energy future.
All right, and our last question, we'll go with James first. Sure. And Greg Bowman would like to know, or actually to Mr. Ebell, he asks specifically, what would constitute a consensus in your mind?
Well, it depends on what the issue is. I think there is an economic consensus, for example, that the policies that are being proposed to reduce carbon dioxide emissions will be quite expensive. They will constitute a rather significant percentage of our growth. I think that there are a number of consensus on various issues. For example, there was a consensus of the models, all these things here, the model runs, that from 1980 on, there was going to be a significant increase in the global average temperature. The actual data shows a very tiny increase. So there was a modeling consensus, which has been proven to be wrong, and there is a data consensus, which now, the IPCC and even some of the alarmist scientists have now said, well, yes, we now have to explain why there's such a large disconnect between what we predicted with the models, the computer models, and what the actual data says, the temperature readings. So there's two consensus that need to be resolved. Now, are we going to resolve it by saying, well, the models are right and the data is wrong? Or are we going to say, well, there must be something wrong with the models that they have gotten wrong, that they haven't been able to replicate the data? So that's I think, how science can move forward, by having hypotheses in model runs and then testing it against the data and adjusting the hypothesis until you can somehow explain the actual physical world. That's how I think we will achieve a consensus, finally, a real consensus on climate science.
James, what's a consensus in your mind?
So a consensus to me is 97%. 97% of scientists in peer-reviewed journal articles, the IPCC, several studies in the past few years have said that global climate change is happening and humans are responsible for it. Now, to address Myron's point about this economic consensus, I agree. I think we all agree that it's going to cost some money, but I think more importantly, it's going to cost some ingenuity, which, as long as we're stuck in this debate about is this happening or isn't happening, which frankly, if we really wanted a truly representative debate, there wouldn't just be one person from each side. There'd be several people sitting next to me at the table, and maybe a couple sitting next to Myron. And I do agree it's going to cost us some money, but it's going to cost us far less money to address this issue now than if we keep kicking the can down the road. Before I came here, I was watching a TED talk by Bob Inglis, who's a former representative from South Carolina. And he presented a very conservative case for why we can get towards a less emissive future of more efficient energy production. And he talked about, I mean, it's a little heterodox to me, but he talked about cutting subsidies for all fuels. I don't know if I agree or disagree with that, but the fact that we're having that debate and we're moving the debate in that direction of how we're going to actually address this, that to me is what's exciting and where we actually need to be moving forward. But in terms of consensus, 97%.
All right, we'll leave it on that. Okay, and now I guess we'll get to ask questions of each other directly. James, why don't you go first?
Okay, thank you.
Question for Myron.
So Myron, again, I appreciate being able to debate with you here today. Thank you for coming. And I'm sad that we can't have some time off the record afterwards at a bar or something like that where I can just ask you. I hope we'll probably get a very different answer if I ask you now versus if it were over a beer or something like that. But I want to ask, what's your motivation for looking at the facts as they are? Consensus upon consensus, several scientists coming to the same conclusion all across society that yes, climate change is happening and human beings are responsible for it. And just denying the reality of that. I mean, I'm happy. I don't mind if someone says, okay, I was off base, I was wrong, I made a mistake, let's go towards this answer. But I don't understand why the resistance. Why is this so hard or so not something that you want to accept as a truth?
Thank you, James. I'm interested in the truth.
Okay.
And I believe it's a great idea to base public policy on things like the Constitution, first of all, and belief in freedom, limited government. But second of all, it's important to base it on the truth. And over the years, I have read not only hundreds, but probably thousands of scientific articles. And I don't see that consensus. I don't see that strong consensus that global warming is a huge problem. Yes, we have had a bit of warming. Most of its effects so far have been beneficial to humankind and to the planet. If you've noticed during the 20th century, crop production has gone way up. Why is that? Part of it is due to the climate. Part of it is due to higher CO2 in the atmosphere, since plants depend upon CO2 in order to be able to photosynthesize. And I don't see these large impacts that are going to be so disastrous. What I do see is some very expensive policy. And I don't think that we should base public policy that is going over several decades to cost trillions of dollars on what a very small cadre of very politicized scientists say. And they say, trust us. I believe trust but verify. And that is, or to go back to the 70s when I was growing up, and perhaps you were growing up, question authority. And I don't think in this debate, the people who normally question authority have been doing that. They have been saying, no, you have to trust the people in authority because they know what the answer is and they know what's best for you. I don't believe that, and so I question authority.
Okay, and do you have a question that you would like to pose to James?
Well, I would like to ask you about this. You mentioned the 95%. The IPCC is not 95% of the scientists. They believe that it's extremely likely that a majority of the warming in the 20th century has been caused by human activity, namely burning coal, oil, and natural gas. Now, as this confidence level has gone up, you will see here, they from one report to the other, increased confidence, likely 66%, very likely 90%, extremely likely 95%. That's reports 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now, at the same time, there's been this huge divergence between what the models predict, which is what they base their confidence on, and what the data. So I would like you to just say, where do you think the consensus is? Where is that going to be resolved in terms of a consensus? Are we going to trust the models or are we going to trust the data? The data says there hasn't really been any warming for the last 17 and a half years. That is, there has been no statistically significant increase in the global mean temperature for 17 and a half years. 99% of the models, 98% of the models, 97% of the models predicted that there would be significant warming in the last 20 years. There hasn't been. So I'd just like to ask you, how do you think we're going to resolve that?
Right. Well, thank you for the opportunity to clarify that point. And you are correct. So the IPCC report says that there's 95% certainty that human activity is causing observed warming.
A majority of it. Yeah.
I beg your pardon?
A majority of the observed warming. Most of it. More than 50%.
The dominant cause.
Yes.
That is what it says.
More than 50% is what they mean.
The dominant cause.
Right.
And so with reference to the studies, it's 97% of scientists. So thank you for the opportunity to clarify that. And do we need to stop?
No.
Okay. I don't know where, I mean, this is cut out from a section of the report without context. So, I mean, I can look at it and see that you've put a bunch of lines together and that it's from some graph. I really can't speak to where it comes from the report and what point they were trying to make. So I don't think it's really fair to respond to one graph that's cut out of isolation.
But you do agree that there has not been any statistically significant warming.
There has been.
As
1.8 degrees Fahrenheit.
In the last 17 and a half years, the current IPCC report, and even Michael Mann in National Geographic this spring admitted that there hasn't been any warming for 15 years, is I think what he said. So the question is, how is that going to be resolved? Because as Michael Mann said in his National Geographic article, that we know that there's been a pause in the warming, which wasn't predicted, but we have too many explanations for why that is. Well, here's the real explanation, the most obvious explanation. It may not turn out to be the right one, but it's the most obvious, and it's not the one that Michael Mann or the IPCC even mention. The models are tuned too high. The models assume that the climate is much more sensitive to carbon dioxide levels than it is. And that's why, although carbon dioxide has been going like this, the temperature has been flat. That's the most obvious explanation,
yeah,
isn't it?
The temperature hasn't been flat. It's been 1.8 degree Fahrenheit rise since the start of the Industrial Revolution, and we're well on our way to 4 degrees, if not more.
A lot of that happened before we started burning a lot of coal, oil, and natural gas. So let's not...
Since the start of the Industrial Revolution.
In the 19th century, it was minimal. So,
and it's only gone up since then. So there is...
And the warming has not gone up. Most of the warming was in the late 19th and early 20th century before we started burning a lot of coal, oil, and natural gas. So, you have something to explain. I think the scientific community has to explain this. And Michael Mann said we have to explain this. But, of course, the most obvious explanation is that the climate is not as sensitive to carbon dioxide levels as the models assume.
1.8 degrees Fahrenheit, and I can point to all the effects. I can point to the West Antarctic ice sheet breaking off.
That's been no.
I can
this,
point
this
to
the, is not a
new
study.
The twisting the of the jet stream. You did ask me the question. I can point to the record hot years that we've had in the past decade. I can point to all the droughts, all the floods. I mean, you can look at the actual observed effects, or you can look at the temperature rise, 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. That's what the models say. That's what the consensus is around. That's my answer.
Do you have anything further that you would like to add to James? Or?
Well, there are all kinds of issues here. The West Antarctic ice sheet it's been known that it's been decaying, and it's been predicted that it will take several thousand years. A study came out this month or last month that said, it may only take 200 to 900 years to collapse rather than 5 or 6 or 7 thousand years. Well, that's an interesting study. We'll have to see whether anyone believes it after further research is done, other papers are published. 5 or 10 years from now, we may have a better idea. But one paper doesn't prove something, usually. I mean, there are theoretical papers there, Einstein, Newton. They prove something with calculations. But climate science depends on data, observation, and how to handle data better. A lot of data has been handled very sloppily. We saw that with the hockey stick, and that's why the hockey stick is no more. Nobody says that there's a hockey stick anymore. It's they've shut up about it. So it seems to me that we have a situation where there are all kinds of claims. I mean, James just once again claimed that we've had all these hot years, all these droughts, all these things. If you look at the IPCC chapter, the consensus among the experts is that there's no historical trend in the severity or the frequency of extreme weather events in the 20th century and into the 21st century. So you're denying the consensus. You're a denier. I'm sorry, but that's
That's a clever flip, Myron, but I'm afraid that's not what I'm doing. I'm reaffirming the consensus that we need to move beyond. I mean,
all right. Okay, and now it's time for We Agree, where where each guest names something the other one said that he agrees with. We'll start with you, Myron.
I agree with James that if we follow the policy prescriptions of the alarmist community, it's going to cost people around the world a huge amount of money, and that is not just wealthy middle-class Americans, it's poor people in poor countries who currently lack access to modern energy, to electricity, to modern transportation, and who do not enjoy any of the benefits of modern industrial civilization. And if we want to keep them in perpetual energy poverty, then we should follow these prescriptions. And if we want to improve the world, we should go for policies that are based on access to abundant and affordable energy.
And James, one area where you agree with...
Well, I disagree that that's what I said. I agree that it will cost us money. I agree that it will cost us even more money if we don't address the issue. And I believe I said the bigger cost will be on the ingenuity front, which frankly we're not going to tap into if we're continuing to debate whether or not this is even happening, which 97% of scientists agree is. I do agree that that the world's poor are, I think, least in a position to be able to deal with this. Here in the United States, if you live in a certain class, you live in certain cities, you're largely buffered from the effects of current climate change. And I think that's only going to, there's only a matter of time before that ends. And frankly, even that's a diminishing number of people who are shielded from the effects. Elites who can afford to air condition their homes more, who can travel to go to places that are warmer or cooler depending on the season. I feel like if you look at the developing world, it's even more expensive, and that's why we need a concerted global effort to address this. And we need to open up the conversation about ways to address it. There's no one way. I'm not saying we just need to throw tons of money at it and that'll fix it. I'm saying we need to throw ideas, we need to throw conversation and discussion and consensus at it and move beyond this idea of there's no consensus. There is a consensus. 97% of scientists agree that global climate change is happening and humans are responsible for it. And now, as policymakers, as individuals, as community members, we need to decide what to do about that.
All right. Well, that's it for this week.